Hi, and welcome to our service. If you're new here, you may be wondering who we are and what this church is all about. Well, the heart of the matter is this. We're a group of people doing our best to love God and love those around us. One of the ways we express this love is through worship, because our God is truly amazing. He created everything, great and small, and His love for us is incredible, powerful, and completely unconditional. We also spend time looking into His Word, the Bible, and receive practical teaching to guide us along His path in our everyday lives. But it doesn't end when the service is over. Throughout the week, we gather in groups to serve, pray, reach out to our community, and sometimes just to hang out and have fun. Life is full of challenges, and none of us are perfect. But we believe that's one of the reasons God has brought us together. We're all here to help and support each other through each step of life's journey, because nobody should have to travel alone. So thanks for joining us today. No matter who you are, we want you to know you are welcome.
I don't know. Oh, there we go. Yay! Happy Resurrection Sunday. We are so glad to have you in the house this morning. There is just something so special about joining together with your family to celebrate the resurrection of our Savior, Jesus Christ. We just welcome you here. Do we have any guests that are in our home for the first time today? I know I met one lady today. It was so nice to have you. Welcome. If you are here, oh, a whole row back there. Welcome. If you got one of these, we'd be glad if you could fill it out and drop it in that bucket. And if you don't have one, I can give you this one. Did you get one of these? No? Okay. I'll come back and give this to you when I'm done. And then you can fill this out and drop it in the bucket for us. It's just a little welcome packet. You can leave your information for it. But we are so glad to have you in the house this morning. If you are joining for the first time online, we welcome you, and we encourage everybody, if you have not done so, to text Connect to 757-320-5615. That's Connect to 757-320-5615. That just helps us keep you informed on what's happening here at the church. We are still just so amazed at the generosity that everybody does with pouring in their tithes and offerings into the house. It just keeps things moving and flowing. And none of this could happen without you. The lights, the heat, the air, none of it can happen without the generosity of the saints of this house. And if you are new to giving here at Open Door Church, there's a few ways that we can give. We can text give to 757-320-5555. You can give online at odcsuffolk.com/give. You can pay through your bill pay on your bank. You can mail it, you can drop it off at the office, or you could put it in the bucket in the back marked tithes and offerings. We have two. We also have our food pantry that is the third Saturday of every month, and there's a basket over to the, I don't know if that's the left or right side, but that way. There's the shopping basket, and you can put your donations in there. You can send donations and mark it for the food pantry. It is just greatly appreciated to keep Suffolk fed, especially during these trying times. Our nurseries are open after praise and worship, so if you have an infant, you're allowed to be dismissed right after. And then the toddlers, we just stagger because there tends to be more of them. So toddlers are the twos and the threes. The door is over here. This side, again, I don't know if that's your left or right, but that side. But the toddlers go through there and just stagger it. Again, I am just so excited to be here in the house today to lift up the name of Jesus. There's just something special about celebrating Easter, and that we get to do it in person is just so amazing. So let us lift up a shout of praise to Jesus.
Amen. If you guys could stand up, we're gonna get loud and celebrate this morning.
I'm
the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive.
I'm gonna sing,
I'm gonna sing in the middle of the alive. Not my will, but yours be done. Gethsemane, where heaven met me. Redeemer, crowned in endless praise, my Savior, name of Hill. gift of eternal life. For the gift in your sacrifice. Thank you, Lord. Oh, the power of your blood. Oh, the power of the cross. Oh, the power of your blood. Thank you, Lord. King of kings, Lord of lords. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation. Seal the promise, your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning, the promise. alive, y'all. That's awesome. Oh my, thank you, Lord. You're alive. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, what a mighty testimony. What a mighty testimony. Our God is alive. He is not dead. The grave did not hold him down. It did not keep him. That is awesome. That is so exciting today. Every day, our God is alive. Inside of us, he places his Holy Spirit when we ask him into our life, when we ask him to save us, that we believe in him, that he can wash away every sin and free us from every chain, every chain. What a mighty God we serve. Mighty, mighty God, we love you, Lord. You're worthy. Hallelujah. Oh, God. We love you, Lord. We ask that you breathe into us even deeper, Lord, that this revelation of the power, of the mightiness of who Jesus Christ is, not was, but is, gets deeper into us, Lord, that every chain can be broken. Lord, you are awesome. There just are not enough words to express the magnitude of who our King is. We love you, Lord. We thank you for this privilege to be called your very own. No one can tear that away from us, Lord. When we ask you to be ours, when we ask you to forgive our sins and you into our hearts, nothing can separate us from the love of God. Nothing, nothing, nothing. We love you, God. We want to continue celebrating you, Lord, throughout this day. Lord, and we're getting ready to have a dance. And these young ladies have put their heart and soul into this, Lord. But every little thing you give us, Lord, every sunrise, every sunset, whatever it is, every gift or talent we have, we can give it to the Lord. We love you, God. Thank you so much for today. Let us remember that Easter, we celebrate today, but every day we can celebrate it, Lord. You are alive. We love you, Lord. Amen. 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 And Lainey and Kaylee Denny's are going to come up now and share in a song called Throne Room.
Dream after dream, you are speaking to me, breathing word after word of kingdom come. Here at your feet, I can see the unseen. Truly, one look at you and I'm undone. I run to the throne room, I run to the throne room.
Throne room, and I fall on my face. you people come from? That's amazing. When we started, it was 7 people here. We're going to get ready to take our communion right now before our children are dismissed. So if you can get your little cups out. Now, I just want to say this, that you have to be very careful because there's 2 lids here. So there's one little thin one early where the wafer is at. So go ahead and pull that one back. Oh my God, Jesus might be coming. When somebody shows up you don't expect, Jesus might be coming. Not talking about you, Hunter. Well, we opened this morning with sunrise service outside. We had a great service. Had about 60-some people out about. And had a great team that helped us put it all together. So I want you to give that team a hand for helping us, all right? It's just good to be in the house of the Lord today. The word of the God says, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. This do in remembrance of me.' And the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" So I want you to take your wafer, your bread. Said the night he was betrayal is an awful thing, but in spite of all that, he still took the bread. He still made the commitment for us, down the cross for us. Said when he gave thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." So we're supposed to remember the Lord today. Remember what he's done for us personally, how he saved you, delivered you, healed you, put your life back together, fixed your mess, restored you, maybe put your family back together. But it's because of his death on that tree. Lord, we bless this right now, this which represents your body. Your body that was beaten and bruised for us. Your body that was wounded for our transgressions. Your body that took stripes that we may be healed. Your body. Your body which was given for us that we might have life and life more abundantly. Let's take and eat right now. I never noticed this until right now. A pause happens. It said in the same way after supper. There's a pause. There's a time of contemplation, time of thinking, reflection, a time of communion and relationship was going on with them at the table. It said in the same manner after the supper, he took the cup. So just think about, just for a moment, what Jesus has done for you. Think about where he brought you from, where you're at today. Just think about that for a moment. Think about some other people that you're related to spiritually in the family of God that you've seen God do powerful things in. He said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. So, Father, we come in Jesus' name. We thank you for your precious blood that was shed for us, that was placed on the doorpost, Lord, in the Old Testament as a Passover, that when you see the blood, you'd pass over us. Lord, without the blood, there is no remission of sins. Without the blood, there's no forgiveness of sins. So now let's take and drink. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for your body. We thank you for your blood. We thank you for all that you've done for us. We thank you for what this season represents. I ask your blessing in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're going to dismiss our children right now. And if I could get you to turn the house down a little bit, Jeremiah, please. I have a little rain going on. There we go. Thank you. Well, it's good to see all of you folks this morning. We had a wonderful, wonderful sunrise service outside. It's the latest sunrise we've ever had here. We had a number of people out. We had some guests out this morning. People live in our neighborhood that came out, so we're pretty appreciative of all that. After the message this morning, we'll be having a baptismal service. We have 4 candidates to be baptized. I think that's like 8 in the last 5 weeks, so we're pretty stoked about that. So just kind of sit back and relax. I would say this, if you've never been water baptized, then we would be glad to do it for you today. We can just take you in just with whatever you have on. We'll just be glad to baptize you. We have towels in the back, but we can do all that for you, okay? If you're a guest with us today, I just want to remind you that if you take your phone out, if you're a guest for the first time, it's 757-320-5615. And that will enable us to make sure that you are notified about everything that goes on here. Praise the Lord. All right, I want you to turn in your Bibles to the book of Mark, chapter 16. This is the message from this morning plus extra. Can I just say, who's visiting today so I can see who you are? Who's visiting? Wave at me if you're a guest in the house anywhere. There's one back there. Anyone else? There's a lady over here. So let's give those guests right here. Give all these guests a hand, all right? Okay. Well, the title of the message this morning is The Tomb, The Resurrection, The Sign. For those of you that were here for the early morning service, which is just a few of you, you know, we talked about signs this morning. So I want to read from the book of Mark, chapter 16, verses 1 through 8, so we can kind of get a little backdrop about what's going on here, and then we're going to share some stuff with you we think that should help you. The story we're going to read to you right now in the book of Mark 16 is also mentioned in the other 3 Gospels. As we talked about last week, there's very few things or events of Jesus' life that are mentioned in all the Gospels, and this happens to be one that isn't mentioned in all 4 Gospels. We're just going to read from Mark 16 this morning. Verses Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of Jesus, and they were going to finish the embalming process. To the tomb, the rising of the sun, and they set him the sepulcher. And when they looked, they saw that the gate, and entering into the cloak, for you seek Jesus of Nazareth, which was crucified. He is risen. He is not. Go your way, tell his disciples as he had said unto you. And they went out quickly and fled from the sepulchre, for they trembled and were amazed. Neither. And we're going to come back and visit that in just a moment, but as I shared the message, I was listening to the book of Acts yesterday. And those of you that are of Pentecostal persuasion that understand the baptism, on in the book of Acts after the very story here, a narrative this to what happened to Jesus here. I want to read that to you as well as I did this morning, because I don't want you to feel like you were. Lifted up his voice and said unto them, "You men of Judea, and all you that are Jerusalem, be my words. These men are not drunk for the day, but this is that which was spoken by the prophet. The last day, saith God, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and daughters shall prophesy visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. My spirit, and they shall prophesy, and I will show wonders in heaven above and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness, the moon into blood before that great and notable day of the Lord. It shall come to pass that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." That's a great verse, isn't it? "You men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus, by miracles and wonders and signs, which God did by him in the midst of you, as you know yourselves, him being counsel and foreknowledge of God," which is a powerful verse right there, "you have taken and by wicked hands crucified him and slain him, whom God raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be holden by it." Talks about his death, burial, and resurrection right here in the book of Acts. And they go back to this. It's like a bookmark. It's like a bookend for them as they preach the gospel and God began to move in the church. It said, "And David speaks concerning this, I foresaw the Lord always before my face, for he's on my right hand, that I should not be moved. Therefore, my heart did rejoice and my tongue was glad. Moreover, also my flesh shall rest in hope. Because thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither will you suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. Thou hast made known to me the ways of life. Thou shalt make me full of joy with the countenance of the Lord. Men and brethren, let me speak freely unto you as the patriarch of David, for he both is dead and buried, and his sepulcher is with us unto this day." Now, you're going to make note of it right here, because he's talking about the difference between Jesus and where he's at, and David and where he's at, and that David was still in the sepulcher. He never was taken out, but Jesus was not there anymore. They were talking about the resurrection. "Therefore, being a prophet and knowing that God has sworn with him to an oath with him that the fruit of his loins according to the flesh, he would raise Christ to sit in his throne. He, seeing this before, spoke of the resurrection of Christ, that his soul was not left in hell, neither his flesh did see corruption." So it's talking about a prophetic utterance here. "This Jesus hath God raised up, wherefore we are all witnesses. Therefore, being by the right hand of God and exalted, and having received of the Father the promise of the Holy Ghost, he has shed forth this which you see and hear. For David has not ascended into the heavens, but he himself saith, the Lord said unto my Lord, sit thou on my right hand until I make thy foes a footstool. Therefore, all the house of Israel knows assuredly that God hath made that same Jesus, whom you have crucified, both Lord and Christ." Father, we ask you to bless your word as we've read it. Bless it to your people's hearts and ears. Lord, bless it as it's expounded upon today in Jesus' name. And everyone said amen. Amen. At that juncture, 3,000 people were baptized. 3,000 people were baptized after that dissertation by Peter. Which is pretty powerful. Have we ever really thought about what was going through the minds of the people on that Easter morning? Verse 1 says, "These ladies went down to the tomb," and they were going down to take care of an unfinished business. You see, Jesus Christ had been taken down off the cross pretty quickly. They had to get him in the ground before the hour of the day went out according to the customs of the day. So there's a lot of logistics going on. Joseph of Arimathea take him down, and they quickly, it says Nicodemus wraps him up, and they put him in the sepulcher. And then, of course, they roll the stone over. They put the guards there as a seal there by Rome. I want you to notice that it was a quick job. It was a fast preparation. They hadn't done everything that was necessary. Not everything was supposed to be done for a dead body. It says that we're going down to finish the preparation, that we're going down to finish the embalming process. And my thought was, as I was thinking about this and perusing about this in my mind, the thought was this: what did they think they were going to find when they got down there? And this wasn't the next day or the next morning. This was 3 days later. Think about that for a moment. A dead body 3 days later. Think about it. I'm going to give you some information about that in just a moment. What were they thinking about? What did they think they were going to find there in the sepulcher? The first thing is that they had to figure out, obviously, on the way down how to get in. Well, that had to be, the preparation for that had been made. The angel of the Lord had come and moved it out of the way, so it was fair travel through there. But this body of Jesus was no different than any other body that had ever been born and put in the ground. You remember the story about Lazarus, where they went down and Jesus told him he was the resurrection of life, and then they go down and Jesus calls Lazarus. They said, "Don't you know he stinks?" Still the same about Jesus, because his body was no different than anybody else. You had to understand, being just like us. He had blood in his veins, just like us, because he had to be that way so he could identify with sin for us. There's no difference. And so they said he stinks. So could you imagine that they never even thought about, maybe he stinks. Maybe this is going to be an unpleasant situation here. No bones broken. He's put in this grave. The world, they thought, body, that they even thought about it. I'm sure your mind doesn't think in 40 years, this particular part. But don't you find it intriguing that they really didn't think about what they were going to encounter? Have you ever thought about that? In lieu of what was said about Lazarus, he stinks. Here's some background here. What happens to a body at death? It's been on my mind all week, so I looked it up. So 24 to 72 hours after someone expires, after they give the breath up, their internal organs begin to decompose. That's 24 to 72 hours. That's pretty quick. They're talking about 3 days, almost the fullness of a three-day event here. It was decomposing. That first note there, they call it pallor mortis, which means paleness in the color of the skin begins to happen as soon as 15 minutes after death. I mean, I've been in to see some people before after they passed away, not even knowing that they were passed away, and they hadn't even put the sheets over them yet, but they begin to look gray and ashen. Some of you have seen people like that. But the skin begins to get pale, and decomposition starts immediately at that point. It's amazing. Then there's a thing called, which means the temperature declines, which is how they can tell, you know, can find out how long a person's been dead. Then there's rigor mortis happens. See Ronnie McClendon raising his hand back. Rigor mortis happens. The stiffening of the muscles starts in about 2 hours after a person dies and gets fixated 8 hours after death, and it lasts for about 20 hours. So just a stiffness happens. And then they have liver mortis, L-I-V-O-R, liver mortis, which means an accumulation of blood to the dependent part of the body wherever gravity is. In other words, all the fluids in the body begins to go to the very bottom of the body as it lays out on the bed. Fluid begins to go to the place of gravity there, to the lowest point, to the place that's pulling it down. In 2 to 3 days, this discoloration disappears in the skin, and then this begins to spread over the body, and this fluid begins to leak out. Made me think of the Grinch, talking about he was leaking. This was what would normally happen to a body. This decomposition, this leaking, this discoloration. This was what these ladies were going to walk into. They were walking into a horror show if that's what was going to stay in place. Essentially, the body that they would find would have been beyond any kind of available preparation. To touch the body would have begun to fall apart or deteriorate. But this is what they came for, to fix the body, to make this body so it was perfect for the embalming process, perfect for the decomposition part. Because as the body decomposed, then the bones would be left. And then at the end of a year, they would take the bones and put them in what they called an ossuary. They would take those bones out of that tomb so they could have it for another person. And they would save the bones in a separate place in a box called an ossuary or another place of storage. You see, his body would have been a mess in 3 days. But they hadn't thought about that. Do we ever think about the signs that are really there? Things that are obvious or should be obvious. His joints would have been sagging. He would have been laying there in these pools of fluid. And because of the fluid, that's why the shroud of Turin that they found, they believe, shows them where the death of the burial of Jesus was. That's why they can see the imprint there, the outlining of the body of Christ. So essentially what occurred was a man was decomposing, stinking, discolored, with no muscular integrity, and possibly disjointed, was raised from the dead. This is what they were going to see. But he was raised from the dead. A body that was falling apart not only was raised, but it was not even recognizable. Not because of his decomposed body, but because of a glorification of his body, because of a resurrection body he got. You say, well, Pastor, how did you go from a decomposing body to a body that's falling apart, to a body that's leaking, to a body that's disjointed, to a body that's skin's falling apart? How did you go from that place to a body that is different, that's resurrected? The tomb is open. They get in there. There's no body. There's no body. There's no stink in there. There's nothing in there. He's gone. The man sitting there, young boy, says, he's risen. He's not here as you suppose. So where in the world is Jesus at? Where is this body that should be decomposed? He's in the garden. How do you know that, Pastor? Well, John 20 says this. And when she had said thus, she turned back herself and saw Jesus standing, but she didn't know it was Jesus. And Jesus said unto the woman, why do you weep? Who do you seek? She, supposing him to be the gardener, said, sir, if you have borne him hence, tell me where you've laid him, and I will take him away. I will do a preparation for him. There had been such a miraculous event had occurred, such a miraculous restoration, resurrection happened when this lady saw him that had seen him regularly for the days of his life on earth, seen him do miracles, had come there to take care of the embalming process. When she sees him, she doesn't recognize him. Wow. A body that's supposed to be falling apart, a body that's supposed to be decomposing, she doesn't recognize him. To me, that's pretty amazing. To me, that's an incredible sign of the power of God. That he goes from literally falling apart, eventually he'd have been unrecognizable because he's falling apart, to a person that's perfectly together and can be seen but yet not known who he is because he's been glorified. He's got a resurrected body. Let me put it this way. When we experience the life of Christ from what we were to who we are now, we shouldn't be recognizable either. Your life should look so different. Come on. Your life should look so different that you have no resemblance of what you used to look like before you were resurrected, before you encountered Jesus Christ. In other words, there should be a real conversion, a real change in our lives that when people see us, they say, oh my, who are you? Oh my, I don't recognize you. Oh my, what happened to you? That happened to me when I first got saved. People said to me, says, what happened to you? Or whatever happened to you, it's really real. We don't recognize you. There's something different about you. That's what resurrection power is. That's why they didn't recognize Jesus, because some new power, a new strength of God had come into his life and made him unrecognizable. There's another story later, the same thing happens. They didn't recognize who he was. You see, our life, isn't that what happens to us? We're dead, we're a mess, we're in darkness, we're falling apart, we can't hold ourselves together, everything's gone wrong, we look awful, and he comes into our lives with his grace and mercy and forgiveness, and all of a sudden we're born again, almost unrecognizable from where we were and what we've become. Aren't you glad for his grace and mercy and forgiveness? Amen. Aren't you glad for his grace and mercy and forgiveness that changes us from who we were to what we are now? See, this is resurrection power. This is what Resurrection Sunday is all about. Taking dead people and making them new. Taking dead people and making them alive. You know, it seems that Lazarus lived on for some time after his resurrection. You know, Jesus goes and calls him out of the grave, which is an amazing thing. I love what people say about this. This is an old saying, but people say he had to specifically call Lazarus because if he just said, come out, everyone would have come out. Think about that. Some of you had never heard that before. Wow, that's good. Thank you. It seems as though Lazarus got a second chance on life. He probably got a chance to live life differently. You know, there's a lot of people say, well, I wish if I could do things differently, I would. If I had another chance, I would do things differently. I'm sure a lot of you would do the same thing. You would do things a little differently. So Lazarus had an opportunity to do things differently, to change some things. And we know Lazarus lived for a while, and then obviously he passed away. He's not here with us anymore. So Jesus gives us a second chance at life. He gives us that opportunity to be born again so that our life will look different and be different and it will be life-changing. See, if you are a believer here today, we need to encourage you. We want to encourage you to continue to walk in that resurrection power. Just because you got saved 40, 30 years ago, 20 years ago, 10 days ago, doesn't mean you stop living in resurrection power and changing power. That means you continue to live that way, and you should be elevating that life. Resurrection power. This empty tomb. See, if you don't want Jesus to renew your faith today, then you're in trouble. If you don't want Jesus to renew his power in your life today, you're in trouble. But there's signs that we need to notice. There's things that need to be understood. Can I just tell you this, just give you a little bit more about this death part? Because I told him this morning that in 1 month, the body begins to liquefy. Isn't that just so fun to think about. All of a sudden, you're just going to be liquid. You're just going to pretty much evaporate. Poof. I never knew this. It's all in the book. Read the mortician book. That's all there. It's mortifying. There's a few of you here, okay? You see, the tomb was where Jesus was laid. It was this temporary place. A temporary place. A place where the launch of his new life, the launch where the real kingdom of God was going to be taking off. It's a sign. They go down to the grave, and that tomb, that resurrection, all are signs. The burial is a sign. The cross is a sign. All these are signs. And some of you are going to remember this song. Back in 1971, this group called the Five Man Electric Band. I don't know if they had another hit or not, but they had this song. It was called Signs. How many remember that song, Signs? Yeah, some of you can date yourself. But that song just kept going through my mind. And so I finally got a chance to look that song up. Now, if we were going to play the song, you'd probably laugh. I won't do that. But it says this in this song. If God was here, he'd tell you to your face, man, you're some kind of sinner. This is the five-band electric band. Well, these guys, preachers or what? They go on to and said, and the sign said, everybody, welcome, come in, kneel down and pray. But when they passed around the plate at the end of it all, I didn't have a penny to pay, so I got me a pen and a paper. I made up my own little sign that said, thank you, Lord, for thinking about me. I'm alive and doing fine. Ooh, sign, sign, everywhere sign, blocking out the scenery, breaking my mind. Do this, don't do that. Can't you read the sign? Sign, sign, sign. Now, you might say, well, Pastor, what are you talking about? I'm talking about the sign of the tomb, the empty tomb. I'm talking about the sign of Jesus' resurrection. I mean, that is what we look back to. That's what today is all about, all around the world. They've already celebrated in Europe, and now it's here in the East Coast, and it's going to the Midwest, it's going to the West Coast, it's going to Hawaii, and then it'll be another day. But God has given us a sign. Not just of this cross, but the tomb, but Jesus Christ, if you read the scriptures, you, now from day one, from right now, I want you to begin to read the scriptures and look and see when you see the word sign or signs, or look at all the different stories and events in the scripture where they use a sign to cause something to happen or to confirm something. It's absolutely amazing. But Jesus says this about the sign. You seek for a sign, and the only sign that's going to be given you is what? The sign of the prophet Jonah, 3 days in a whale. It says that. People looked at the sign of the skies to determine the weather, the signs. And he says, you hypocrites, he says, you can discern the face of the sky, the sign of the sky and the earth, but how is it that you don't discern the time or you don't discern who I am? Miracles many times were seen by Jesus and seen by others outside of Jesus' life. And miracles excited Herod. Even the king Herod said, he said, but I want to see this Jesus. This was just before his death. He said, bring him here. I want to see him. He was exceeding glad because he thought he was, listen, he says he thought he was going to see a sign. But you know what? Signs, listen to me, signs don't really change hearts. We will not believe others, we say, but we need a sign, unless we see a sign. In John 20, it said this, so the other disciples said, we've seen the Lord, but Thomas says, unless I see his hands and the marks of the nails and place my finger in the mark of the nails and place my hand in his side, I will never believe. People want to see signs, but even when they had the signs, they still didn't believe. You don't need a sign, people. Come on. You just need to have faith. You don't need a sign. And the sign that you need is a cross. The sign that you need is another life that you see. The sign that you need is what you see in the scripture. Those are the signs you need. And those are the signs that you need to believe in. Come on. We ask for signs. And even when we get them, we don't respond properly. We don't believe. Jesus said this, he said, have you believed because you've seen me? He says, blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. He puts more credit, he gives more esteem, more honor to a person that believes and hasn't seen a sign. A sign didn't guide their life. If you look through the scriptures, you see all kind of men of God that had to have a sign before they would do something. Gideon had to have a sign, right? Gideon had to have a sign. Listen, folks, if you got to have your life predicated on a sign, you need to stop that because that's going to get you in trouble. Just believe God. If God tells you something, just do it. Don't wait. Don't say, well, God, if you give me this sign, or like this, I don't have a Bible with me, a regular Bible, but people will say, Lord, speak to me, and they just flip the Bible up and stick their finger there somewhere. And it says, go and do thou likewise, talking about killing yourself. Are you going to do that? That must have been a sign. Come on, the sign. Jesus said to them, he says, what sign showeth thou to you, seeing that you do all these things? And then Jesus said this again. He tells them, he says, destroy the temple, in 3 days I'll raise it up. That was a sign. That was a noted sign he gave to them. John 4, he says this, except you see signs and wonders, you will not believe. Listen, signs ain't going to change most people's lives. At least if it does, it'll only be temporary. Signs. Here's another one. John 6, 2. And a large crowd was following him because they saw the signs. Some people might say, well, if God gives me a sign, I'll give my life to him. If God gives me a sign, I'll do this. If God gives me this sign, I'll do that. This is what Jesus said. This large crowd followed him because they saw the signs that he was doing on the sick. If you go down to verse 66 of the same chapter, now notice this, John 6, 66. Everybody knows that numbers, right?
The mark of the beast.
Well, look what this verse says, John 6, 66. Just look it up. All that were looking at these signs, saw these signs, it says, and many of his disciples went back and walked no more. So signs didn't keep anybody. A sign will not keep you. A sign will not hold you true to Christ. You have to believe in him by faith, not seeing, but believing. Come on, people. That's why people are so messed up. That's why the church is all discombobulated, because people are living on signs or living on this or living on that, this manifestation, that one. Listen, I believe in all the manifestations of the earth. I believe in all the signs, but you cannot live your life on a sign. You can't have an experience with Christ on a sign. Maybe you're going to get this. Signs are not enough. If they were, everyone would be in. Come on. If signs were enough, everybody would be here. The place would be full. Whether there was coronavirus or not, there would be people outside. But signs don't cut it, folks. Signs won't get people in, at least not very long. Signs don't keep people. Lazarus was a sign. His hands and feet were a sign. These signs are all over the place. Well, listen, Jesus said something about the signs in Mark 16. He says this, and these signs, talking about preaching the gospel, being baptized, believing, laying hands on the sick, devils being cast out, speaking in new tongues, all these signs. It says, these signs, notice what it says, shall follow them that believe. It didn't say we should follow them. It says they will follow us. Come on. You don't follow signs. Signs follow you because you believe, because you trust in Christ, because you believe in the resurrection power of God. Come on. Signs should be following us, not you following the signs. See, if you follow after or seek for a sign, you'll usually be disappointed. You won't be satisfied with a sign eventually. You see, you'll keep looking and petitioning the Lord until he does what you want or what you think he should want you to do or what you want him to tell you to do. See, Israel looked for signs all the time, and God gave them all kinds of signs, but what good did it do them? What? Come on, what good did it do them? Sign, blood on the door, got them out of town. A few days later, they're complaining. God opens the Red Sea, it's another sign. They go through the Red Sea. 3 days later, they're complaining. God gives them, you know, then they 3 days complaining, there's no water. God gives them a sign. God turns the bitter water into sweet water. God gives them a sign. They're still not happy. Then God gives them out a little bit further. They want some meat, so they want some meat. They don't want this. And God gives them meat enough to strangle them or to kill them, but that wasn't enough for them. And then God gives them some other signs, and God gives them manna every day. But none of that was good enough because they kept doing what they were doing and kept living the way they were living, because signs don't do it. Signs don't change your life, people. Come on. Signs. Everybody's looking for a sign. Sign, sign. We're a sign. For the most part, we've never changed because of a sign. God, give me a sign. Our promises to him, if they're predicated on a sign, probably will never keep them. Here's a sign. God, if I win the lottery, it must be a sign, God, if I win the lottery, then I'm sure if we're going to tithe from now on. Now, you got to say, oh, God, he's talking about money. No, but I'm telling you. They get that money. They win that lottery. I've had this happen. People win these prizes or they win this money. They get promised this and they say, Pastor, as soon as it comes in, I'm bringing a tithe to the house of the Lord because I'm so thankful where the money came and they never brought a dime to the house. Because a sign, folks, listen, that person, listen, I care if you do win the lottery. I don't have an opinion about the lottery. If you win it, then please bring the tithe down here. Let's see if the sign reverses itself. Let's see if it really works for you. But you shouldn't need a sign to tithe. You shouldn't need a sign to do what you're supposed to do, whether it's living for Christ or whether it's being faithful to your spouse, raising your kids the right way, going to the house of the Lord. You shouldn't need a sign for any of that. Well, Lord, if the sun shines today, I'm going to the house of the Lord. And you wake up and the sun's shining, the sun's in the sky, and you still go fishing. Or you still go down to Busch Gardens? Or you still go down to the ocean front? Come on, people. Signs mean nothing to most of us. It's just a catchphrase.
If I get a sign, Lord, God, just give me a sign. I'm
talking about signs. This is Resurrection Sunday. I'm talking about signs. Signs don't really work. If our promises are predicated on signs, then they're all going to go away. Lord, if you get me out of this mess, then I'll live for you. Praise Jesus. Signs never work. Don't seek for signs. Seek faith. Ask God to help your unbelief. That's what the disciples did. Seek Him for who He is. Seek God for who He is. Seek God because He loved you. Come on, seek God because He came from heaven for you. Seek God because He suffered and sacrificed for you. Seek God because He became a servant. Seek God because He became obedient to death. Those are signs that He died on the cross for you to free you from the penalty of sin. Seek Him because He separated Himself from God to come down here to live for you, to die for you, so that you might have eternal life. Come on, that's the signs you need to seek after. Those are the signs that need to run your life. Hope I'm not talking too fast for you. This is what Resurrection Sunday's all about. Taking dead people, making them new. Changing the way we look at things. Here's one for you. People seeking signs. There's a man that was drowning one day. And he was stuck on the top of his roof. In a flood. He's praying for God to help him. God, help me. God, send me a sign. Help me. Soon a man came along in a rowboat. A sign. And the fellow shouted up to the man on the roof that was in the flood. He said, jump in. I can save you. The stranded man ignored the sign. Shouted back. He said, no, it's okay. I'm praying to God, and He's going to save me. So the rowboat went on. Then a motorboat came by. Surely this is a sign. And the fellow in the motorboat shouted up to the man, jump in, he said, I can save you. And to this, the stranded man on top of the roof in the flood says, no, thanks, I'm praying to God. He is going to save me. I have faith. Must not be a sign. So the motorboat went on, and then a helicopter came. I'd rather ride in a boat. But a helicopter came, and the pilot, Charlie, shouted down. Charlie used to fly a helicopter. Charlie shouts down and says, hey, grab the rope. Grab the rope, and I will lift you up to safety. Maybe it's a Coast Guard helicopter. I don't know. They send a basket down. Jump in the basket. And the man that's stranded on top of the roof in the flood, and the waters are rising, and replies, no thanks. I'm praying for God to come. God is going to save me. I have faith. Now he's got three signs, and he ain't really paying attention to the signs. So the water rose above the rooftop, and the man drowned. He went to heaven. Well, it must have been saved, man. He finally got up to his chance to discuss the whole situation with God and what had happened. At which point he explained, he said, Lord, he said, I had faith in you, but you didn't save me. You let me down. You let me drown. I don't understand why, Lord. To this, the Lord replied, I sent you a rowboat, sign one. I sent you a motorboat, sign two. I sent you a helicopter, sign three. What more did you expect? How many times do signs come and we don't ignore them? So I don't want you to live on a sign. I don't want you to live on if it's wet on this side or wet on that side, or if you got, if you do this or that. Don't live on these signs except for the cross, except for what God's word says about Jesus Christ. He was giving signs and people still were missing it. My thought was this about these signs. How often do we miss the real signs? Have you ever thought about that? How often do we miss the real signs? Well, God gives us these opportunities to make things right, these opportunities to clear a slate. How often do we miss these signs? And I would say we miss more signs than we realize because we're not paying attention. You see, we want these outward, these grandiose signs. But you know what? There are people that saw the sign of that empty cross and didn't believe. There's people that saw the sign of the empty tomb and didn't believe. There's people that saw Jesus Christ put the ear of a servant back on that was cut off by a sword, and they still didn't believe. There's all kind of signs, folks, running around, and it doesn't change a lot of people at all. It doesn't even get their attention. It doesn't even faze them. Signs. Signs. So if you want a sign, here's one, or two, or three, or four, or five. Number one is the sign of Jonah. 3 days and three nights. God let him out. There's a sign of the virgin birth in the book of Isaiah chapter 9. It says, a virgin shall conceive. That is a prophecy that came past. That Jesus Christ lives as a servant, that's a sign that his nail-scarred hands, his feet, and pierced side were for you. A bloody back and bruised body, an empty cross, an empty tomb. I say we need a sign. The sign that we need is the cross. But you know, there's people that put their trust and faith in a sign called Aries and Leo and Sagittarius. But I'd rather put my sign in the cross, my hope in the cross. How often do we miss the signs of his great love? He told them early and he told them often about his love and what he was going to do for them and how he's going to be raised again the third day. He told them it was more blessed to believe and not see than to see and believe. Let's begin to believe the signs he's given us. Can you look at your neighbor and see a person and see the sign of Christ in them? Can you look at the person next to you, come on, and see the sign of Jesus in them? That there's a representation of Jesus, that they are living after the image and the character of Jesus Christ. That person is no longer the person that they used to be. And you've probably heard stories about some of the people that sit behind you and around you. You know the person that you're married to, where they came from and where they're at today. Those are the signs that we need to trust in. Those are the signs that we need more of to see the life-altering effects of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Let's do this now. Let's make this declaration right now that I will release the resurrection of power of the living God. I want you to stand to your feet. We're going to get ready to do water baptism. But I want us to make this declaration right now. This is very simple. Obviously, I don't know everyone here. But if you don't know Christ today as your Lord and Savior, then all you have to do is just say, Jesus, I want you to save me. That's all you have to say. So what it says, if you ask, the Lord will save you. Whosoever believeth on the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you're sitting in this room right now, you've never asked Jesus to be your Lord and Savior, just ask him right now where you're sitting. Say, Jesus, I ask you to save me. I ask you to set me free. I ask you, Lord, to give me a resurrected life, a new life in you. But if you are a believer and you've been living less than a powerful life or less than a life that you should be living, you're not really where you need to be with Christ, and things have been muddling your life. Things have been holding you down. Things have been resurrecting your life that are not godly, that are your past. I want to ask you right now, I want you to say, I release the resurrection power of the living God, Jesus Christ today, to live like resurrected people in the name of the Lord Jesus. Now, you didn't sound very convinced as you prayed that. I want to pray that again. I want you to pray this with boldness. I want you to pray this with conviction. I want you to pray this as you mean it, like you mean it, with full of faith. You ready? I release the resurrection power of the living God, Jesus Christ, today, to live like resurrected people in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Give the Lord a hand. Come on. Yeah. Hallelujah. And I believe in God that you will be able to live in resurrection life like you never have before, in Jesus' name. Now, if you just be seated just for a moment, we're going to have this water baptism. This is for today. If I could get somebody to move this table out of the way, I'd appreciate it. Side for the kids. I'm supposed to tell everyone there's an Easter egg hunt for the kids outside over there somewhere, right? Is that where is it? After the service is over, meet at the sign out front of the church. There's a sign outside in front of the church. It says Open Door Church.
What ages?
Ages 5 to 12.
Younger.
All the 12 and under. If you feel like a kid, you can go. Y'all remind me to tell you that. Don't let me forget. It's a secret sign. It's a sign. Go to the sign. All the children go to the sign. Are y'all about ready down there? Yeah. Well, Chad, the water's warm today, so you won't freeze to death. The water is a nice 80 degrees today. The last time Chad entered into the water, it was 60 degrees. He thought he was at the North Pole. But we have three young men, and we have one young lady that we water baptized today. Is it really warm? Oh, it's so nice, isn't it? It's like a sauna. Isn't it amazing I can make this noise while I'm standing up here? It's a sign. I thought I heard somebody. It's a sign. Is anybody in this building never been water baptized? Just raise your hand.
Yeah.
No. You've never been water baptized. Who hasn't been water baptized? One, two, three, four. So what are y'all waiting on? I expect phone calls from to the office this week. If you're waiting for the water to be warm, it's warm. I keep hearing people. What are y'all doing? You having second thoughts? We're all going to resurrect you. We're going to bury you and resurrect you. Let me just say this. This is a true sign of what a Christian should do. The Bible says we should follow in Jesus' steps. And before Jesus began his life's journey as far as his ministry, he went down to the river. John Baptist baptized him. The Spirit of the Lord came down and said, "This is my beloved Son, whom I'm well pleased." And I believe that when we enter into waters of baptism, God says this, that he's well pleased in what we do, because we are showing his death the same way with communion, showing his death in burial and resurrection till he comes. Now, this is Jared. And Jared is, you're 18 now or 19?
21.
You're 21.
Today.
Today's his birthday. And I do want to put you on the spot. I just want to find out that you've waited. Have you waited this long that your birthday and Easter and water baptism will be on the same day? Did you calculate all that?
4 times every 100 years.
So. Y'all, did y'all hear that? He said 4 times every 100 years this happens. This day coincides with Easter Sunday with his birthday.
Wow.
This has got to be one special sign. I want you to grab hold of him there. So, Jared is a miracle child, number one. Sherry and his mother wasn't supposed to be having any children, and she gets pregnant at 45. So she gets a son and a grandson at one time. Think about it. I'm 65 and I got grandkids. She's a little close to my age and she's got a grandkid and a son, 2 in 1. But Jared is an Eagle Scout. Jared is just a wonderful, spirited person, incredible sense of humor. He carries Texas Pete with him everywhere he goes. So if you ever go with Jared, you want Texas Pete. He's got some in every pocket. He's like a magician with it. But Jared decided at 21, he finally wants to get water baptized. His mom is elated. His dad's elated. I'm elated. We're going to hold him down an extra long period of time. We're going to hold him down until he stops moving. But Jared, since you have confessed Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you now want to enter into the waters of baptism to show that you believe in the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, but that you also believe in newness of life in Christ. So, Lord, we ask you right now, Lord, we ask you to bless Jared in his life's journey. We ask you, Lord, to bless him in his desires and goals in life. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for the witness he's been to the community, as a servant in the community, as a servant here, Lord, and just giving his life to you. But, Lord, he's taking another step today. He's making another statement publicly, Lord, that he hasn't done before. He is showing your death, your burial, and your resurrection right here in front of us, that he's identifying with it, Lord, just like the other candidates are identifying with the death, the burial, and the resurrection. Lord, what a powerful testimony. And Lord, that we'll be raised in newness of life, God. And so I pray, Lord, that the life that he experiences after this day, Lord, will be far surpassed anything he's ever experienced before. Lord God, we pray that you fill him with the Spirit of the living God, Lord. We pray, God, that you do something supernatural in him, Lord. Lord, we pray, God, that you move in his life in a way, Lord, that just breaks him out of his shell, Father, Lord, and causes him, Lord, to go into a hyper drive in his life. So, Lord, we thank you for Jared. We thank you for his parents. We thank you for their diligence to serve and to keep him in the house of the Lord. We thank you, Lord, that he is a miracle boy, Lord, but that was just the beginning, Lord. God, you have many more miracles for him. You have much more for him to do. So, Lord, we pray that you fulfill, Lord, your will and desires for his life. So, Jared, right now, as we take hold of you, We baptize you today in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. Hallelujah. Glory. All right. So I believe we have, this is her nephew. No, your grandson. Well, whatever. He's nephew, grandson, son. He's family. This is Ryan. Look at Ryan. Ryan, look at these people. No, look at him, Ryan. Yeah, you look at them. So grab hold of Mr. Chad there. He's going to grab you. Lord, we pray for Ryan, Father. And we pray, God, that this will be a new day for his bloodline. A new day for his bloodline, Lord. A new day for his heritage, Lord. Lord, that the fork in the road, Lord, is going a different way. It's not going to go the broad way, but it's going to go the narrow way. It's going to go the way of the kingdom, Lord, the kingdom of God, and not another way. So, Lord, we dedicate him. We commit him right now to your will and your way for his life. We thank you, Lord, that he likewise is desiring, Lord, to show your death, your burial, and your resurrection here, Lord. And we pray, God, that he would rise up, Lord, from the watery grave here, Lord, with newness of life, that something divine would happen to him, Lord, something supernatural would happen to him. But God, he just wouldn't be getting wet, God. But, Lord, there would be a transformation and an energizing of the Spirit of God that would come about him and come upon him. Lord, we pray, God, right now. For Ryan, and we ask your blessing upon him, Lord, as he obeys your word. So we baptize you right now, Ryan, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Off you go. And we have another fella. This is good, people, men. Men, boys, getting baptized. That's what we need, men and boys. Men seeking the kingdom of God. This is Matthew. What a great name, right? Named him after one of the Gospels. I'm sure they did. So this is Matthew Darden. And his daughter, Sophia, is coming up too, right? Hallelujah. Yeah, listen. No, okay. Let's just pray for Matthew. Lord, we pray for Matthew. Lord, we know that he gave his life to you a long time ago. Lord, we know he's got a godly heritage in his family, his grandparents especially. And Lord, we pray, God, today, Lord, that you would do something supernatural in him, Lord. God, just take him to another level. Take him to another level, God. Do something so incredible in his life, Lord, as he is obedient to your word. He's doing what Jesus did. He's doing what the Scriptures command us to do. As we read today, that first day, the day of Pentecost, they preached, Peter preached, 3,000 souls got saved, but they also got baptized. So, Lord, he's following in the steps of biblical teaching, Lord. So they were saved and they were baptized, repented, saved, and baptized. So, Lord, right now we thank you for Matthew. We pray, God, that this would, Lord, help him, Lord, in his life. And, Lord, help him put all of his past behind him, Lord, and a new life be made known to him. So, Matthew, we baptize you right now in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Praise the Lord, man. Hallelujah. Booyah. Okay. And his little girl, Sophia, right? Look at this little tiny girl. Woo!
Almost done already.
She's so beautiful. And she's so serious. Father, I just pray right now for Sophia. Lord, she's so young, so tiny. But Lord, you said, suffer the children to come unto me, for such is the kingdom of God. Lord, you said, out of the mouth of babes and sucklings, you've perfected praise. Lord, there's something about the children. Something about the children, Lord. So, Lord, if we can capture the children at young ages, Lord, we can begin to turn our culture. You begin to turn this thing on its head, what's the world is like, and we can turn it back to God. We can have a real reformation, Lord, a real revival. So, Lord, we pray for Sophia, God, that she would be one of those that could turn the world upside down. She'd be one of those that would change the culture. That she'd be one of those, Lord, that would use her voice, Lord, to speak your word, to speak your name unashamedly, Lord. We pray, God, that you give her boldness, Lord. Even as she has the boldness, Lord, to enter this water of baptism before these people, many that she doesn't know. But, Lord, her boldness is that she wants to declare what you've done for her. That you died for her, that you rose again the third day, and that you ever live for us. So, Sophia, right now, I baptize you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. All right, let's all stand up. Come on. Hallelujah. So, Lord, we thank you for your people. We thank you for this day. We thank you for resurrection, power, and life. And we pray that you would bless your people today. Lord, let them experience the resurrection power of Christ like never before in the days to come. Lord, we pray, God, for transformational converting power to effectively work in us. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Give the Lord one more hand. Love somebody. Fist pump somebody. High five somebody. Have a great day. We love you all. And everybody's got to go out the front door. Front door only.